because it solved the problems that they were actually having as realtors. So I have been exploring Remind before it was a Remind Pro is included in your Bright MLS membership. And now we have Docs Plus included in your NVAR membership as a member benefit. So I have been a explorer of Remind for many years, and now have challenged myself since October to use the Docs Plus platform for most of my contract work. And I'll explain maybe some of the limitations, but so I am going to share. And I will try to just show you guys how to, if you need help logging in, I mean, you can get to it via Bright. So it's a part of the Bright Premium tab up here. Not anymore because it's not a premium feature. It is just included. So it's under the Market Research tab, and you can click Remind Pro, and that is your single sign-on, and it'll take you right into Remind. And you have this dashboard. You can also, for example, you can get to it via a listing. So if you are in an actual MLS listing, you can click on this little thing here, and this will take you into Remind at that actual listing. So you can, you know, it doesn't have to replace Bright, or it doesn't have to be the only thing that you utilize, but it can be. And in fact, I find myself using Remind instead of Bright most of the day. So I'm probably at about 70-30. I use Remind for 70% of my day in and day out activities in real estate, and Bright for about 30%. So that's kind of how you can get to Remind. And then you can also go to bright.remind.com and log in that way if you'd like. But so when you get into Remind, you have these side silos. And so the one that we'll be focused on today is Docs. And what is kind of cool about this is, which I think Instanet did this too. I never was a big Instanet user, but when you're actually in a listing, you can create a transaction right from that listing by clicking this feature. We won't do it right now, but just to know that you have a lot of different ways to transmit information in these products, because the whole goal, and I think that's when NVAR makes decisions to get a product for us, they do it with the idea that we want to save you time or save you money or save you both. And so I think Remind in general, in conjunction with Bright, does a lot of that. So we're going to click on the Docs platform, and I will forewarn some of you. So I'm a principal broker, and so there might be some features that I have that you don't because of that status, which I think is basically the impersonate user. And then I have these submissions that I don't think everyone has. But other than that, this should look fairly similar to what you have. When you get into Remind, because I most certainly will not cover everything, I am going to cover this as I use it. And some of the features I haven't used personally, but I can talk to them. There are guided tours. There is support that you can have. You can also, if you want a more full screen experience, get rid of all of that and just use the icons. But so you have all of these little tabs. You can see the amount of documents you've created, the active users, etc. You have your transactions. So these are all the deals you might have or whatever you've created, and you can create whatever name you would like for them. You can put personal documents in here like I have. I had to sign something for personal use, and so I did it through Remind Docs. And then what you should do in general is to save time, you should create packages. And so the idea of a package, I know when I was a Zip Forms user, I had created contract packages for listing agreements, for buyer representation agreements. I had gone so far as to make offers, you know, for VA and conventional or with a condo, without a condo. That was probably overkill, because if you fill in most of the information, but I was like, at this point in my life where I thought I needed to shave 13 seconds off of everything I did. I have since relaxed a little bit. But you can create packages. You also have your form libraries. And so this would be like one-off documents. If your brokerage has documents, I don't know if I have anything in here. But like, for example, if you have like a COVID document right now, like some people are doing hold harmlesses, you could put it in here. If there's a photo addendum, if there's an affiliated business arrangement, as a broker, they could put it into that forms library. And I think as an individual, you could also have one. You have a clause library. So this is the idea that if you have certain languages that you're using regularly, like during the heat of the market, you might have had a modification to an appraisal contingency. You could quote that language in here and go back to it and use it again. You also have this feature, which is checklists. And so within checklists, I feel like some things are missing. I do feel like I actually have things in these categories, but maybe it's in more groups. Nope, do not. So like with checklists, this is with each contract, you want to have these five things, right? So did we order the condo docs or did we receive them if you're on the buyer side? And so those checklists can go with the actual documents that you're collecting. So you can use this like a DocuSign deal room or I don't remember what ZipForm calls it, but like document rooms in general. And then submissions would just be if your brokerage is using this, you can actually submit documents to your broker for their approval or for their review. And again, I feel like I have some, but I definitely have approved them. And then you also have announcements, which is you can take a tour and read the article. But this is not unsimilar to what we have when you log into to Bright, where you can make announcements for the office as you might want to. You have your settings, which you can create your initials and how they'll look or how they'll be formatted. And then it just has some information on you. And so like little things, I don't know if it just defaults to this, but like you would want to make sure your time zone's correct. So when people sign documents, it's in the right time zone. So with all of that said, I would like to just create a transaction. And I probably won't create every detail of it. We'll try to skip some steps. If you have, if you have questions, put them in the chat. I will try to look at them. Matt will be monitoring. Daniel will be monitoring. But so what we do to create a transaction is we can click here, create a transaction. We can click in an actual listing and create a transaction. When we do that, we get the same window, if you can kind of see. Well, actually, I guess the difference is, so you can see this is already filled in. So this just populated because I created the listing in Remine. And so the only thing I would need to add is the full legal names of the buyer. And so I'll use this one, I guess. One thing to know, the Remine system does not allow one email address to have multiple names attached to it. So in the event you have a client, we've all been there, it's not a good practice from a risk reduction standpoint, but that says, I don't email, can you send it to my wife's email? And so you send both documents to the same email address. Remine Docs Plus will not allow you to do that. So they'll have to have a different email address if they are receiving it. As you can see here, could not add more than one person with the same email address. This is just a warning in this case, but I'm representing the buying side. This is the MLS information. It pre-populated the names of the sellers. And when I hit next, unless it's giving me grief about this. Let's see. All right. We're going to leave that blank. Then it asks me what forms do I want to use? So if I had like a company document, so I have a COVID acknowledgement that's built into my company docs, or I can actually go into packages if I had one prepared, which apparently I don't. But I can click on the NVAR forms, and then these documents come up. And so like this was probably the most interesting part of working with Remine, is that they know the numbers for our documents, whereas I suspect most of us know the names of the document. But it's a really robust search feature. So you could actually search by the number of the document and it would come up, but you can also search by the name of the document. So let's just say sales contract, and all of the documents with sales contract come up. So I want to add, and the recommendation is always, always, always the first document you want to add is the one that has the most information, because that's what triggers these smart documents to populate. So like if you're writing an offer, and let's say you have, you know, it's got a financing contingency and a home inspection, don't make that the first document that you put into this selection, because it will limit what actually gets populated after the fact. So you would want to start with the residential sales contract, and then I'm going to add the financing. And again, if you make a package, like you don't have to do this. I'm just, obviously I have not been using it as much as I advertised, I guess, or I've been doing this every time. And then we're going to add a home inspection. And for those of you who don't know what a home inspection is, that's when a buyer gets to look at the house and inspect it for performance before they buy it. We used to do them all the time. Okay, so I'm going to add these three documents and I'm going to hit next. And if you remember, it knows who's involved from the last screen. So now I'm going to take the residential sales contract. And when I open this up, there's going to be some information already included in it. So the buyer's name, which is myself, seller's names, which is a real seller, house is under contract, the city, property address, unit number, all of that information is pre-populated. And if you set up your packages correctly, you can actually have them pre-loaded where some of these variables, like what type of financing it is, et cetera, will actually already be included. And so this is what's kind of interesting. So if you watch, when I click on conventional, because these are these very intelligent documents, when I click on conventional, it populates this automatically that this contract is contingent or not contingent. So keep that in mind, that it's gonna help you know what things are sort of required to be filled in. And so we'll say it is, I think it knows that since I added a financing contingency addendum in my package down here, that it should include that this contract is contingent and there's an addendum attached. So really smart stuff that's happening behind the scenes, again, to save you a little bit of money. So I'm gonna just go through and fill out a little bit of information. The other thing that's very interesting is that if you're using a document from the NVAR library, and you've identified the sellers and buyers involved, they're automatically going to have the initials filled in for you. Same with signatures, same with dates where it's relevant for these NVAR forms. So that's, again, just another effort to save you some time and energy. And what it also does as you're filling this out, right? So like right now, I cannot fill in this property owner's information. And the reason is because I have not selected whether it has one or not. So if I select it's not because it's a condo, still can't click on this, right? So this is helpful in the sense, like if you're a newer agent or maybe have some inexperience with the forms, or you know, every July can't keep up with what the changes are, even though you definitely should, and I know you'll get to it in August. These documents can help you avoid making common mistakes. But once I select that it isn't a homeowners association, I kind of wait a second, and now you can see this information is fillable. So if you're a broker out there, I think one of the reasons I like this is I can avoid risky situations or incorrectly prepared contracts by using Remine instead of Zip Forms, Instanet, these national brands. Like Remine has made these documents for us in Northern Virginia for the NVAR forms. So anyways, let's say, we'll leave that for, I'm not going to necessarily fill in information, but again, you can see with conveyance items, if I click no, it doesn't ask me how many. If I click yes, this box opens up and now I can put in a number, or I can put in, verbiage, whatever I want. So this is the idea that these are smart documents, that they were not, they're not what Remind called them, were flat documents. And so those are, you can upload anything you want into this and have it available to be signed. However, they're not smart documents. So it's not going to know that there's an opening for text or information that you can add. But you can add anything you want and use, and you can edit things. And I actually love using this to respond to offers, because it has some really great, strike through tools, and it's really easy to drag and drop signatures and the like. So anyways, we're going to assume that I filled this out in its entirety, but maybe I missed something. So let's pretend for like 2 seconds that I didn't miss 90% of this. We'll pretend I missed just one little thing. So I am going to prepare to either send this or sign this. So if I click sign and I say I want to have all of these signed, or I could click select all, and then I hit continue, it's going to ask me, since I'm representing the buyer, I've already filled in the email address. Oh my God. Am I sure that I want to continue? Because I left off this one important detail. And so it's got red triangles for things that are sort of significance. And it's got orange triangles that are like, maybe you didn't mean to put it there, but like you probably should go back and just triple check. And what's cool is like, if you click on this, so like, as you can see, there's like a gray bar that hovers. So if I click on that, it'll actually take me to the relevant text, right? So again, just another way to like ensure you're filling something in, or we've all had, I hope it's not just me, those like moments when you send off a contract to be, prepare to ratify it or prepare to send it off, and you're like, oh crap, did I put the financing, did I put 21 days? So this is just another like a level of verification that will help you do your job effectively and without errors and within compliance. So if we hit continue, even though we get those warnings, the red ones and the orange ones, it's not here to stop you. So I can hit continue and it will still allow me. And so if you're with your client, they can actually sign it right in front of you by clicking the sign now button. And if they're not with you, as is probably most of the cases, you can send it to them to sign it. So I might have to pull up another email. This is not an email I use all the time. But you'll see, so I'm sending this off. Just be prepared. I do not clean out my inbox, and I just want you all to be prepared for that. And I also have a lot of email addresses. So in this one, it's kind of cool. So Bobman has shared documents with you. So this is what your customer will see if you email it to them. So it says, oh goodness, here are the documents. So you can literally click on the information or you can view all docs. I think it goes to the same place, but I'm not 100% sure. And so this is, since I'm using the same computer, can you guys all see this screen that I'm showing you? Yes or no? Just a quick one.
Yes.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
Thank you. There's nothing worse in a Zoom meeting besides standing up without pants on than being in a window that no one can see. So it says, it looks like you're already logged in as Rob Whitman. Click continue to be logged out of your current session and proceed as Rob Whitman, which is the other Rob Whitman, as you guys are well aware. So now I've received this document as a customer. And so what is the advertised feature of this is that since this is like this living document, is that if all of us were using this together, you know, it's, if you work at one brokerage, you might have Dotloop, and if you work at another, you might have DocuSign, or you might have Authentisign. But if we were all using Remine, you could actually come in here as a user and change a detail. And when you change that detail, everyone would be notified. It would have to be agreed to. But so since this person is not able, it's sort of locked at this point. All that I can do is hit sign. So after I've reviewed it, I can hit sign, and it gives me my progress window here. So I click here, draw a signature, type a signature, whatever you want to do. So we're going to say I'm good with that. That's how I opt into this. What you'll see is, boom, boom. Okay, so I'm not going to sign everything. I'm going to hit done. I have not completed signing everything. And I can, so again, it's just like, hey, wait a minute, you're missing this stuff, but it's not a gatekeeper. So you can come back to it later. You can hit, do it whenever you need to. And as a result, you as the agent, should get a notification that's like, Rob Whitman opened up your documents. So for some of you, you may not have this feature in your current signing platform, but you can see that, okay, Rob went in and then stopped. He's missing 10, he's missing 4, he's missing 3, but you can get notified that someone's using your the link that you provided and signing the documents. So that's how we do like a quote unquote normal transaction. So let's say that I wanted to upload a document. Give me one second. Let's see. So this is a picture. It's just easiest thing to find. But I just want to show you how like a flat document is treated. So you can select a destination for it. So I'm going to throw it into personal just so it doesn't messy this up. See, I had to send a doctor's paperwork and I used Remind Docs. So let's see, this file cannot be previewed. To view and mark it up, please convert this file to PDF. I can do that right here. So it's going to clone it and convert it. You can also reorder PDFs. You can do anything that you might have other software for. You can probably do it in Remind. So in the Docs Plus. So what's cool is now this is this document that I had, and we're just using it to illustrate the point. But so let's say I needed to, so I got a counter offer and I needed to respond. It's just effortless to type in, fill in information. The box gets bigger as you need it, et cetera. So that's really cool. You can change the font if you care about that, the alignment, color, et cetera. Let's also think for a second, if somebody puts in a term we don't like, right? So we're like, actually, it's not coming soon. This is on the market. Where'd it go? Hold on one second. Crossed out rectangle. I love using this feature. You can just cross out the entire thing. Again, you can change the size, the style of it. How do you want it to look? Do you want it to be like very, if you've got an English teacher in your family, you might want to use red. My mother's an English teacher, so we use red for mistakes. Or you can use black if you're trying to be low key about it. But anyways, so you can modify contracts, and then you can, we know Rob is the buying agent, so we can just throw an initial right there. And now this can be signed, right? If we needed to add a signature. And if there were multiple, so say you had two or three buyers in this and you had a listing agent or something, if you populated that information in this people section, So right now, just it's just treating it as me. But if I added, you know, Golden Bridge Rob as the seller, when I go back to the document and I add in an initial, it's going to say, oh, okay, did you mean Rob W, the seller landlord, or did you mean Rob W, the buying agent, right? So you can select who you want to include in this. And so here we go, we've added a signature there. And then what do you want? Do you want to include the date? Do you want to include the date and the time? Which is something DocuSign has done recently that I cannot unchange. So that's part of the reason why I'm happy to use Remind Docs. What else can you add? You can, you can do little check marks. So like if conveyances are wrong, and if you want it to be a big check mark or you want it to be a super small one, you can adjust those things. And then if you are like me, sometimes I get a little frustrated when initials get out of control. So if you want to put like a circle adjacent to those, and then you want to throw an initial inside of the circle, so everyone looks, you know, neat and organized and professional, and you want it to just be the initial, you can hit done. So there's a lot of versatility in this. And then once this goes out to somebody, it's just like a signature program. But again, when you're using this document, if you wanted to, so with this one, there's not a whole lot of crazy things to sign. So let's see. Seller, add a recipient. Let's see, listing agent, message. Missing from the following document. Let's see. I think I might have to delete something really quickly. Try it one more time. I don't know if this wanted me to convert it to a PDF. Let me see. Okay. I don't know why this isn't working, but of course it's not. But I think it's because I selected a JPEG, so I apologize in advance. I'm not going to stress about it, and neither are you. Okay. It should be a PDF. I am going to document. I'm going to upload. I'm going to be quick about it and add this PDF. And now this is a PDF document, so I'm going to throw in a real quick initial. Oh, look, so it downloaded it as a PDF but without the actual initial filled in. So we're going to hit done. And now I'm going to hit send. And now I'll hit continue. So there's a lesson learned. Don't upload pictures. And so now I'm just going to add me. And I'm going to send it. and it says document has been shared. And so when I receive that on the other side, I'll be able to sign off on it. And I'll also, as the agent, be able to monitor this progress, right? Let's see. So I'm going to pause for a second, because that's uploading documents, that's using forms, that's transitioning from Remine into the Docs program. Let's see. So we have some questions about people having errors getting in. We'll connect offline about that. Okay. Oh, hi, Amir. You're representing the seller and trying to add a buyer. So Amir is explaining, thank you, why it's not working for me. So I need to, got it. You're representing the seller and trying to send to a buyer. So the system doesn't allow me to do that. So if I, Amir, I'm running out of email addresses to use. Let's see, but I have more. Okay, so if I do that and I go back. Actually, I don't know what I'm trying to accomplish. You can just click representing buyer. Okay, thank you. So now I can hit sign now because I'm Rob Whitman. And I can click to initial. And it's done. And if I have, let's see. Signature saved successfully, this little blue dot. I can now send this to the other agent involved. And I will receive this document. I'm not going to open it up in my email, but now I can see this. And so in the future, when we're all, you know, when we're all using Docs Plus, instead of having all of these like X'd out, if you're actually using the smart document, it will just change the actual document and send it out for the relevant signature. So if you changed on page one, the sales price, instead of having it be like all marked up, I mean, I think this is sort of the like Remind idea for the wave of the future, is instead of having all this like minutia everywhere and going back and forth 15 times, instead you'll have this really clean, crisp document, and you'll be able to see the history of the document, which is in this tab up here, and see like, oh, okay, like, on December 1st at 2:37 p.m., Rob Whitman changed the price to $3.49, which will make maybe life a little easier for some of us. So, because I know after you go back and forth three or four times, sometimes the contract looks like it was an idea and you used it for scratch paper instead of an actual legal document. So once we get to a critical mass of users using this, then we'll be able to do that effortlessly. So that is one of the hopes and goals in preparing this. So without keeping people unnecessarily longer, is there any particular feature or tool or question that I might be able to answer or demonstrate for you or hear from anybody who has been using Remind Docs Plus in their professional life or
Rob, personal life? Rob, we had one question. We had one question that I think is really great to touch on. So it says, if a husband and a wife only have one email address, what can you do? Can you just copy it and take them to sign in person? So I think this is a good junction to talk about the importance of the email authentication and how that works, especially with the smart forms.
Well, so I don't know what the solution is, except that, you know, so this is my principal broker hat, which is, you really don't want people signing on. Maybe the individual is actually opening, you know, the wife's email and signing it themselves, but that's really hard to prove when you're using electronic signatures. So you know, it might mean that you do need to do it in person. And Amir, I sort of welcome if there's any recommendations from the Remind side, but it really is like in our best interest to make sure that the right people are signing it. And so if they don't have an email, you might have to do it in person, which you might have had to do if they didn't have an email anyways.
Or you could create an email address for them. I've done that where I've created a Yahoo account for them so they can use it just for the signature purpose.
Yeah, that's above and beyond. And Heather is bringing, it sounds like many people up to 1994 standards. So we appreciate that. but yeah, so I think in general, if you're dealing with that situation, I mean, you want to find a good workaround that ensures that these documents are trustworthy.
So thanks for adding me there. There's a, if it's a Gmail, there's that plus function that you can use, which is, it's a bit of a complex workaround, I suppose, but it works perfectly well. I use it all the time. So if your email is rob@gmail.com, you can just write Rob plus, you know, 123@gmail, and that the system will basically redirect all of that to Rob@gmail. And it's effectively the exact same email, but it's tricking the system with the plus sign. That only works with Gmail though. Another way you can try something here to like dry run the system is to use the test contacts. I don't know if you've seen that or not. But if you go into pick out any form there, you've got just add a form of some sort.
Okay.
And then inside of this, you can add, so you've got all your people here. If you go into people and just type in something next to one of the buyers or sellers or whatever.
Okay.
No, just go back and type in the word test.
Got it.
Let's say test. Actually, go into like listing agent or something like that so that it's a new person.
Got it.
And type in test.
Oh, rest. What's on my mind? Okay, test.
I guess L for listing.
Okay.
Should come up with a test listing agent. If it's not coming up here, it's because you've already started the transaction. But basically, test listings and test sellers, they'll come up in these situations here. I'm not sure why it's not coming up for you there. It's because you probably already got people in it, so it doesn't want to add test people now. Okay. But if this was from scratch, you could type in test buyer, test seller, test listing agent, and it'll just resend everything back to you if you guys like want to dry run the thing.
Got it. Okay. And I mean, I have obviously illustrated that I have too many email addresses, but that is how I started in this, to Amir's point, is I just sent it to my various different email addresses, but Gmail has some workarounds with putting a period or as Amir was saying, adding the plus sign. So I mean, I do think it's worth, anytime you're using a software or a document product, obviously, to give it a once over of how to experience it. Or send it to your spouse. I mean, my wife has dealt with many signature templates, has bought many houses for me. Okay, how do you click for the date? So I'm looking at some questions. Did we answer all of them? It looks like there's several that have been answered. I'm gonna look at the open ones really quickly. So.
Yeah, I've left the open ones for you, Rob. Some of the ones that I'm able to answer just in a short typing thing, I've been answering as we go.
Okay, so I'll do my best here. So it says, how do you click for the date to be signed by clients? So I think the general answer is, so like if a date is required, so when you have this signature preview, it is automatically, I believe, going to be filled in on these smart documents.
Yep.
So you don't have to worry about it if it's an NVAR form from the forms library. If you want to just add one, so I don't think it will let me do this. Yeah, it won't let me do it in this one because it's an NVAR form. But it, like in my PDF example from earlier, you'll just have the option to add a date. Here, and you just put the date. So I don't know if that answers it perfectly, but
the other thing you can do there is if you just grab the signature tag, just click on signature there to your top left somewhere. Yep.
Yep.
Grab a person's name, drag a date down there. And then on the right, you can pick and choose time, date, and you can move that around.
Yep. I actually used that in the most recent contract that I ratified on the listing side. It was super helpful. Saved me those 13 seconds I'm always trying to get back. Okay. So I don't know if that answers you anonymous or not, but we're going to say we did. Will there be a separate dashboard for managing brokers as we have with Instanet now? So I am a broker of one. So my agent is fantastic and does everything on time, but you do have this dashboard if you are a, I think you have to be registered correctly with NVAR to get the appropriate credentials for this. So if you're a managing broker, you would see these submissions, and with these submissions, you would have the ability to approve them, the documents. And so like with this, we could say needs attention, and then I would get a notification that it needs attention, right? As the agent.
And we can help facilitate all of that for any brokers, but really it's going to depend on how your account is registered with Bright MLS. If they have you down as a broker, you should have access to the dashboard.
Got it. Right. And so I, as a broker, when this changeover occurred, I didn't have to do anything. So again, it's just making sure that you are appropriately identified in NVAR system, and then that should translate to the Remind system. Wiley Bean asked, what if there is no MLS? So I did this example the last time that I went through this. Oh, I had signed. So because I have used my multiple email addresses, I had signed out. So Remind is now kind of allowing me back in as Rob Whitman. So give it a second. But so I will, my house is not for sale, except for the right price. So I will type that in really quickly. And what comes up is my house. And so this doesn't have an MLS number, obviously. So we're doing this together. And I can go into create a transaction. And when I do that, I can say, so let's assume you're buying something off market and nobody knows about it. You can begin to go through the exact same process as if it had an MLS or not. So that's a really great feature slash opportunity. So if you're preparing your listing agreements, if you're writing offers, when something's off the market. So Anonymous said, I like seeing the lines that have been marked through, changing the price. And I think clients like seeing what it used to be versus having a clean doc. That's an opinion thing. I know as a principal broker, I used to hate seeing so many lines, but I hear you, it might be a preference thing, but I do think in general, the future of documents is that they are like this. So, you know, adjust to it or don't, or still do the markups like I've done. The world doesn't end, the tools are in, you can do either one in this platform, so that's great. And then is there a place where I can input all parties' names, email addresses in advance before I open any form? And the short answer is, yeah, definitely. So I just, when I'm here, and another, I guess, pro tip, I think this is right. Let me think about this for 1 second. No. Yeah, so I have, if you use Remind as a tool, you can actually have contacts that you can add. And so if you upload your database or your contacts, you can, when you're creating a transaction, those people can come up. But right now, unless we lobby super hard for it, there is no connection to like Google Contacts or an address book that you might be using to automatically upload it. But I would like love that. It would make me so happy. But so if you have the people in your contacts, they can be pulled up instantly. Also, if you just want to get it all out of the way and you want to say Rob Whitman, who I had, you know, in my list, and then my wife, who I don't have in my list, you can hit enter. And then when you're actually in the document, it'll ask you for the email address, but you can actually fill in everybody's names. And somebody asked, can you copy and paste? And I don't see why you can't, but we'll try it really quickly. Yes, you can copy and paste. But yeah, so you can fill in the information in advance. And then when you get into the weeds of it, you can add their email address or whatever you want to do at that point. So answered 13 questions. 13 is my lucky number. Are there any other questions or anything someone would like to see like acted out? I would encourage anyone who has not used this tool to use it, to give it a try. One, it's nice to have a backup. I am provided, so obviously AuthentiSign and Instanet through my NVAR membership. I am afforded DocuSign and Zip Forms included in my my real estate franchise. And I am most comfortable, most interested in using Remind, two reasons. One, it's a local company and I like supporting local businesses. Two, if for some reason I left my franchise or if something happened with their arrangement, I kind of like having a little more control over this and knowing that this is a free backbone, makes it much easier for me to try to make this commitment to this software product. I, full disclosure, hated AuthentiSign. Like, I guess we have like a month to go, so I shouldn't speak ill of the almost dead, but ugh, was awful for me. But DocuSign, either DocuSign or ZipForms had been letting me down recently where I would click on something and then it wouldn't show up and I had already sent the offer off. So that happened to me 3 times. And so I have yet to have a problem with this.
Rob, can you show me how, if you were not creating a document within Docs Plus, but you wanted to use it as a signature service?
Oh, yeah. So that's, I mean, I kind of did that with the image, but it's just.
So the same thing as that flyer that you uploaded?
Yeah. So there might be a workaround to it that I am not familiar with, but
DocuSign costs $200 plus a year, and once I have a chance to get into this more detail, I plan on canceling my DocuSign because that's quite a cost saving. I mean, my membership to NVAR is about less than a little under $300, and I'm getting a $200 benefit just using this instead of DocuSign.
Spoken like a true
board member, I know.
No, it is true. It's so true that, you know, our business is hard enough and you're scraping by and, you know, each one of us has to make financial decisions for ourselves. And I don't know about you guys, but I can put $200 into advertising. Like, I want to spend money on things that make money. I think most of us are that way. I don't know anyone who's ever said DocuSign did this for me or AuthentiSign did this for me. And so, you know, you're not going to find that, but what you're going to find is a really beautiful looking product that reflects on you to the people you're representing. I showed you what the user experience is in signing it. And it's a really easy, simple way for them to sign the documents. I've had youth, you know, tech savvy, youthful individuals use it. I've had, you know, Nana and Papa in Indiana use it and nobody's really come to me with a huge problem. And Remind's available if you have questions or if you have concerns. So I think all of those are helpful. Like, tell me who you would contact at DocuSign, right? So we have that locally, you know, locally or in a sense. We do have one last question. I'm going to treat this as the last question. I am going to fulfill my New Year's resolution from 2020 to end meetings earlier than they need to be. So it says, what if you are representing the seller and a purchaser rep emails a signed offer that was signed digitally? that document will typically be locked for editing. So would that document not be able to be edited, marked up in Remind Docs? So if it's sent through the Remind Docs portal and someone opens it through the Remind Docs portal, if they make a change, it will require the parties that are involved in that document to initial or sign them before the contract is considered ratified. But there is a place, or there is a point in time in a transaction where you can actually lock it. So we'll treat this document like it's donezo. And so I actually don't know, maybe because it's not signed, I can't lock it. All right, I'm gonna take you out of my personal world. Oh, okay, so I locked it. Sorry, at our house we are running, everybody is on a Zoom meeting right now, if I had to guess, even my five-year-old. But so this document is locked now, and so nothing can happen. This is blocked out. Nobody could make any changes. But if you had that situation where everybody was using it and someone made a change, it would then send that one singular page that had been changed, if it's an NVAR living document, and it would require everyone to reinitial it for that agreement to take place. So hopefully that answers it, and you can unlock, you know, whoever is the agents involved can lock and unlock it, I believe. But I think once it gets locked, it's donezo. Who puts the ratify date, and do you lock it at that time? I think that just comes down to how you handle it now. I know sometimes I receive the contract and the ratification date is not there, and I will put it in. I know when I'm representing the listing side, if I'm the last one, when I send it, I typically put in the ratification date because I use a signature software to add that date. So I think that would just be like it is now. It's at your discretion who puts it in. Let's just make sure it's right. And then worst case scenario, if you've been using Docs, you've got the history tab, so you can always go back and actually confirm when that lock date was. Okay, well, 3 minutes to go. If anybody ever needs anything, I am always happy to talk about this stuff. I love Remind. I find their tools really easy to use, and I've made it a huge part of my business. So you can always reach me if you have questions about it. If not, NVAR staff is here, and Remind staff is here to help.
Thank you so much, Rob. I really appreciate it. And that was we covered a lot of ground and a lot of territory. I mean, I think a lot of it is just comes down to familiarity and, like you said, testing it out. But there's hopefully everybody can see why our board of directors decided to go in this direction. You're going to end up with clear, enforceable contracts without missing material terms, and you know, easier to understand the intent of the parties. And then you've got the audit trail to show every step of the way who changed what, why, and when. So we're pretty excited about all this. Really glad to hear your and Heather's enthusiasm about it as well. But we will be holding these trainings throughout the rest of the year, and we'll likely continue that into the spring as well, because we know that there will be additional questions. Feel free to contact NVAR as well. But then the Remind customer support is also on standby as well, and they're quite responsive. There's tons of tutorials, videos, FAQs. There's trainings by Amir Kadri. He joined here briefly today. He's a member. He's on the Remind Docs Plus team, and he's done a bunch of demos for us as well. We have some of those recorded. They're up on the YouTube page and up on the website too. I did put in the chat, anybody who is a current InstaNet user who is interested in learning how to back up your files, please consider registering for the next session, which starts at 3:15. They'll walk you through how to go back and back up your files before the cutover on January 1.
Don't wait, try it out now.
We did it, it's 2:59. All right, I'm out.
Thanks, everyone.
Thank you again, everybody. I hope that everybody has a wonderful day.
Thanks, Rob. Matt, did you say there's another one starting at 3:15?
It's a InstaNet backup, a document backup training.
Oh, okay. Okay.
It's primarily for InstantEd users to show them. It's a pretty easy process, but it requires a couple of steps. So we're trying to show everybody how to back up their files expeditiously, so they're not waiting to the last minute.
Great, Matt. Thank you. I think I'll pass on that one since I'm not an InstantEd user. But I'm glad I sat in on this because it was very helpful to understand the format of training.
Have a great day. We always appreciate your thoroughness and preparedness, Heather. Have a wonderful day.
All right, Matt. Bye-bye.
Thanks, Daniel.